All right.
Wow!
So let's go ahead and start tonight's story. And let me clear my throat for just a second. And we will... I'm going to switch over to my map screen. Because this is the scene that is before us. We see a long subterranean room. The stone looks freshly worked by either extremely skilled hands or perhaps even elemental magic. There are two rows of supporting pillars, four pillars in each row. At each column are chains. Everywhere there is blood and the sounds of cutting, pulling, scraping, and tearing. Around the room are many tables, each equipped with restraints. A few of the tables have bodies on them, flayed and partially hollowed. They are of varied sizes, but are past the point of knowing any race or age. There is just enough left of them to scream. There are two other figures in the room. Oh, there are a few other figures at those bodies. Those are the cloaked figures in red bearing daggers. There's one at each table that has a body. There are also two other figures at the end of the room near the entrance. One is cloaked like the others, only in black. And another is a woman. Gaunt skin and no love in her eyes. She looks pale and dead, but behind that is some bit of beauty. And the cloaked figure speaks. "Do you think we have enough to start?" And the woman replies, "The rite of pain has already started. We need enough to finish, and this is not enough. He requires as much as there is available. Do you think that task impossible?" "No, mistress." And her shape begins to change. "He will get as much pain as there is. Do you understand?" And she begins to transform from this small woman into a snake. Well, she has the body of a snake, only she's like 13 feet tall, and that's with the bend from her support. Only her torso is humanoid with a woman's chest and arms, and the face is still there, only this time much, much more beautiful. Only it's buried in that of a snake with a wide cap, kind of like a cobra. "Shall I include yours in the mix?" "No, mistress, we'll get it done." Her shape fades back again into the woman. And she walks towards the door. "Get as much as you can. There is plenty of pain in the city of Greyhawk to go around." But we are not there. However, a few of our characters may be familiar with a similar place. We are back at the Whistling Fish Inn, where Grunab the Hill Giant runs an inn that seems to cater to foreigners mostly, especially people who might want to not be under the constant scrutiny of the stranger's eye. And what were you guys doing last?
Sitting, talking, waiting on drinks.
Killing
time? Was it? It was nighttime, wasn't it?
It was, yeah, I think it was fast approaching. We had had a conversation, and I was trying to gain as much information out of Leaf and Bogard as I could before Kay and Aaron and I went off to find the warehouse. And I believe Bogard and Leaf were interested in adventure. I'm not sure.
Correct, man.
That was something you planned to do tonight?
Why not?
Going to the wharf?
Like, what time is it? Is it already dark out?
Well, let's see. Let me piece some things back into my head. No, there was mid-morning. It was about midday when the chase with the city watch happened. You guys had your little thing downstairs and then met up with Kay, rambled off to the 440 city watch. That happened in the afternoon. So I would imagine that you had to stop over at the monastery and... Then
walk
you
back to the foreign quarter.
Yeah, so it's dinner time. You've had supper, a couple of drinks, perhaps, depending on what you do, depending on whether or not you had committed to going out before you ordered or after you ordered, I guess. But that's where you're at. You're at the table with the possibility of food, drink, and the discussion as to how you're going to plan out your evening.
Aaron, are we ordering food or are we going?
I mean, I could eat. You know, it's been a kind of a long day. But
I mean, they do a hell of a whitefish here.
Well, yeah. I mean, we might as well grab something, keep us going. But I expect we gotta get to where we're going. Sooner rather than later.
Kay, you want to eat before we go?
If you want to go tonight, I think we should probably leave as fast as we can. There's a lot of strange folk out at night at the wharves. So we either do it now or in the morning, I'd say.
What about you two?
I mean, I could eat some bacon, man.
Leaf, you look pretty exhausted.
Is Leaf asleep?
Leaf is just staying really close to Bogart.
I mean, if you have
the,
if you have things to do, let's do them, man.
Well, listen, I don't know how long this is going to take, okay? What do you think, Aaron? Do we go? Do we just go?
We got stuff we can eat on the way.
All right.
Should I stay or should I go? It plays in a jukebox in the corner of the medieval tavern.
You go tip the bar to 2 copper to get him to play your favorite Clash song.
Yeah.
Oh, I was just about to ask her if she could tell me who did it.
The bard's really getting it in the corner.
It's Psy.
The whistling fish is known for, because it is such an amalgamation of people from other cultures, it is known for its trendiness. So if you want to go see cool bards doing their thing,
The Whistling Fish is probably the best place.
Yeah, I love this song.
Some people think it's a little too edgy, but...
it's not for everybody.
How far is the walk from the foreign quarter to the wharf? Hour?
You guys enough should have spoke for, up.
Rat folk? You attack us?
Hey, man. What if my best friend is a rat? It's not cool.
I'd actually meant for you guys to see that map. I forgot to put you on it. You still are on the starts page. Scream sometimes. That's all right. You can interrupt me.
But I don't notice things.
I know we're all used to live theater acting where everybody zip it until he gets out of it. just let it go. This is a little different media. I only know this because I watch other people screw up on live Twitch streams all the time, and they just go, oops, I fucked up. Well, let's see. If we... you guys, this is the big map of the city. And here, I'm going to do this cool little shift-click thing, and it should bring you guys down to my little circle.
Is that supposed to show up on the Twitch stream, too?
Here, I can do that. Yeah, thanks, Jaylee. Ba-doom-bum-bum. Yeah. Map screen. Let me get rid of that thing. That looks better. Yeah, I'm getting better
yes!
at that. I learned a whole lot last night, and then this morning I had a nice video call with our resident Roll20 specialist and learned even more new cool stuff. So,
Yay, Beth!
Yeah. And, they had a great game last night. It was fantastic. So you guys are, down here kind of in this building, not kind of, you are in that building with the little red dot. There is a gate that takes you outside there, but that's, the road is kind of hell and gone from the wharfs. Your best bet is to go straight up back to the city like you were headed back up to where Dad works at the city watch station up there where that yellow box is.
Yeah. That's a hell of a long ways.
That first yellow box with the red dot in it, that's the city watch station in the foreign quarter. And that yellow box up by the wall, that's the Dark Sun Monastery. Dark Moon Monastery. I am forever doomed to mess that up.
It's all astral.
Let's see. Dark Moon. I have it written 1,000 times over here. Dark Moon. And the gate there is... the wharf gate. That takes you right there. That would have been the gate that you know nothing about. Well, you guys know about it. That's the gate to the wharf. Those who live there, you're familiar with what goes on in the gate. It's a tremendously busy gate. There is lots of city watch there, lots of traffic, two lanes of wagon traffic, two lanes of foot traffic going both directions.
So are we talking about an hour? Or are we talking about 2 hours?
How
long to get to the gate and through and out to the wharf?
No, you can just strolling along the city. It'll take you an hour to get up there walking.
Okay.
Maybe not even that long. Where's my handy dandy little measuring device here? So yeah, we're measure, damn it. No snapping. There we go. Okay, so yeah, you'd have to go let's see. That's Dad's place. So it's really 3,000 feet as the crow flies ish. So, yeah.
A mile.
Yeah. And through the city at night, you know, between half an hour and an hour.
All right. I say let's go.
So we're going, man. Let's go.
Finish your drinks.
Bogard slams the second drink. Hands up and starts walking draggingly if he has to.
Yeah, no, Luke. Yeah.
I'm just going to throw you over my shoulder.
Okay.
You take a nap on the way, okay?
Okay.
Brother, you want to lead the way? I'll bring up the rear.
Can you cradle me instead? I feel like I could
take that's fine. Or if you want to like lay across my shoulders.
We'll just like put a blanket on her so no one looks.
Yeah, if that's the case, I'm totally going to take my cape off and lay it over her so that we don't have a 7.5 foot tall cow person with a 4 foot tall cat person laying on his shoulders.
It just looks like he's carrying a dead child. Much less suspicious.
That's not an uncommon sight in the city of Greyhawk, probably.
Touche.
I am 5 feet tall, damn it.
I'm sorry, the 5 foot tall cat person.
You got Tucker Excuse tail. Me.
Who's a good kitty? Who's a good kitty?
Yeah, I'm sure she loves that.
Oh, I get scratchy tail. She
secretly does.
Yeah, quiet purr, like really purr.
All right, let's go. We'll take off for the wharf gate.
I'll be right behind Aaron then.
You best be. I don't know where I'm going.
You said you'd take the lead.
Well, he takes the lead through the city to the wharf gate. You know how to get there.
True. All right.
Technically, all three of you know where you're going.
I'll be up front with Aaron, but I'll probably try to lead us through streets and alleys that aren't as populated. To try to bring like lower attention to us, since we do have this giant cow person carrying a big bundle of cloak, to just try to get us there as fast as we can.
It's really not too bad. It's the same, pretty much the same systems of streets that you guys came in on. There used to be. Map that had the street names on it. I'm gonna have to pull that one up. And you pass by the same big temples, you'll pass by that same big gambling house, the Silver Garter, which if you are looking at like the did I leave you guys on the big map? Yeah, if you're looking at the if you follow that river, you take that path that goes kind of up the street and then crosses the bridge and juts around that little river there, that great big building that is on the wrong thing, Curtis. Yeah, right there. That's a giant casino. The Silver... What was it? Yeah, oh yeah, the Silver Garter. Great big place in the Foreign Quarter. Hugely popular. And that big main street, if you stay on that one, you're going to go by the bathhouse. You'll pass by a couple of famous shops, the Red Serpent Restaurant, some really cool stuff of the Foreign Quarter shops and things as you pass up and get closer to where the City Watch Station is. And the City Watch Station is kind of built right in the center of activity as far as that was to go. You know, they're right in the heart of where everything is happening, because right across the street from the City Watch is the Barge Inn, which is a huge restaurant and bar and inn that is just as big as that gambling house. All of that, you'll happen about halfway. You probably get halfway is the City Watch Station for the most part. And then as you continue up the highway, you'll go by that. As you head getting closer to the gate, you see that little round building there with the little red dot on it. I gotta remember to look at my map and pull that down. It's right up here by the gate. Oh, I'm pointing that one out for K. That is a warehouse.
Okay. Is that the warehouse?
No.
Or just A?
It is the warehouse. It's unique for a couple of reasons. One, it's a great big, huge stone structure with, it's brick, but the blocks, I should say, that are used to build this round warehouse look too big for man to manage. One interesting thing. The second thing is it's round, and because it is a known warehouse, it has a reputation for what's in. You have to forgive me. I bifocals. Sometimes I have to look over. Tarnak McGlugan. It's Tarnak McGlugan's warehouse.
McGlugan.
Yeah. And so it's just one of those little landmarks that, you know, you think of as you walk by and you get close to the gate and you're like, oh, there's that warehouse, man. It's like the one thing, you know, it's like knowing where Hoffa's grave is, but you can't get to it.
Is he like, who is he?
He is a dealer in fine oddities.
Okay.
Don't tell Bogard about that place. Or do. Might be
fun. We'll see if it comes up.
I think the meta pigeon told you. The other place of note is right across the street as you get closer to the gate. The other last dot there on your right, that building is the guild station of the Night Watchmen. And I want to mention that because, one, the Stone Brothers are going to be familiar with that. The Night Watchmen are what you would call the local militia, as it were. That is like Neighborhood Watch with steroids. And so these guys, and a lot of them, are very faithful servants of St. Cuthbert, so they are very heavy-handed. But they are very lawful, and they are very good, and they are the guys who patrol at night, because at night, the City Watch sleeps for the most part, because their job is to protect the city. They do run rotations and do patrols and manage the gates, but for the night, the bulk of them end up in their quarters unless there is something going on to which they're required. And so the Night Watchmen have kind of taken up the slack, as it were. And so they have their own jailhouse. It's separate from the City Watch stations, and they are like the City Watch stations. They have one in every quarter of the city, below the high wall. So everything in the foreign quarter, the artisan quarter, etc., south, they're not up there in the garden quarter with the swells, as they say. And that is the guild station of the Night Watchmen. They run a guild. The guild house is their jailhouse. And so that is the last place you go. So that is the night jail, as it were.
Okay.
And then you get to the wharf gate. The wharf gate is well lit and a bustle of activity. There is a line of foot traffic going out, a line of cart traffic going out, a line of foot traffic coming in, and a line of cart traffic coming in as well. I say carts, wagon loads of stuff having been offloaded from the boats, getting loaded onto the boats, coming in and out.
March up, get in line.
Now, is this going to be like the gate when Fossick went through? Like, are they going to try to charge us?
Demand yes. payment? When you get to the gate, they are going to charge you the same free sword tax. They charge it both ways through the wharf gate now. And they're also looking for contraband, so you are subject to inspection.
Okay. I mean, are the people who run the gate, like, are they run by the Night Watchmen, or would there be a chance that maybe with
no, my connections these, I would
know someone.
These are straight. Yeah, no, these are straight up City Watch.
I'll go three. Okay.
No, these are City Watch, and the City Watch comes in two variations of patrol. There is the normal patrol and what you would call an elite patrol. An elite patrol is going to have a sergeant and possibly even a captain amongst the regular nobodies. And so the I had to wave bye to the wife. The wharf gate, actually, you see, has a captain and probably two or three sergeants, as well as multiple regular city watchmen that are climbing up into wagons and undoing nets and yelling about shit and opening boxes and doing that sort of thing.
So it's an elite patrol. Okay. Love that.
Would the guards here be familiar with us as the Stone Brothers, or is that out of the question?
I could go. We're on city watch business.
They would probably not know you at this point. Not on, at least not on the night shift.
Fair.
And it's a different quarter.
Okay, well, if nothing else, I would assume that Aaron and I would lead the way. I have no problem standing up front. I have nothing to hide.
Yeah, Bogart's definitely in the back. Leaf, have you had enough of a rest?
Dime bag away.
Yes.
The dime bag of holding.
Yes.
So yeah, I mean, you approach the gate. You can get a sense of things, I suppose. Who's up at the front? One of the Stone Brothers.
Yeah, the pair of us.
I learned a little trick. I'll have to tell you guys this. If you go into my settings on Roll20 and you see your little display name, here we go. This is what we call Old Curtis's Learn to DM Moments Live. And on your display name at the end, you can put your passive perception, and then it shows up at the bottom of my Roll20 thing, and so I can kind of glance over. Just a little trick that I was informed about. Beth does it all the time, apparently. So I looked over and I said, what's everybody got those little numbers by their names for?
Dandy.
Smart.
Yeah. So well, Aaron is fairly perceptive. It just looks normal to August because, you know, the guard that it looks like you're probably going to intercept is, or have to deal with, is grumpy, I'll say, you know, tired. Tired of dealing with garbage or crap or whatever it is that he's had to mess with. And so that is the tone of person that you're going to have to deal with. And if you just stay in line and get to him, I assume you approach him like as a group, as if you were about to get on a carnival ride, or
yeah. I'm not letting the other three, you know what I mean, lag behind.
Right. Okay. So when you get up to him, he'll looks at you. You guys look relatively straight, I suppose, and then looks over your group and he starts to say, yeah, I need all your swords, bags, belongings. What do you guys got on you? And at that time, you see that he's distracted and kind of looking around and over you at your companions.
What's the normal price here? What's the normal price at the gate?
It's 2 gold a sword through the gates.
Okay. I hand him 10. And say, square?
Well, you're paying for all of them, huh?
Yeah, I'm responsible.
Even those two back there?
Yeah, especially those two back there. Square?
I don't know. What do they all got on them? He's eyeballing them, looking them over.
Listen, I got 3 swords. I'm giving you 10 for all 5 of us, all right?
Make a persuasion roll.
Oh, man. Rolling.
He's got a 20 charisma.
This is why Kay isn't talking with her 9 charisma.
What was it?
Natural 18 plus 5. 23.
Oh.
Oh.
You're charismatic as hell.
All right. I think we're square. Who are you, anyways? Do I
August
know
Stone.
You?
Stone. Son of Aaron Stone.
It used to be like a musical sting. Like, I'm August Stone. Da, 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 da.
Did you hear that? A dog. I've heard there's this mastiff around biting watchmen.
I heard that story earlier today, too.
It's bloody awful.
Yeah, you should watch out for that. We'll see you later, all right?
All right, so he takes your gold and is definitely giving each one of you the up and down as you go through. But he doesn't harass you. And
I stand there with him and let everybody else pass, and then we go back into the same order that we were walking through the city. And
It is what you would call some sort of organized chaos, because there is a group of city watchmen that are fielding people that get to the front of the line. And then, of course, they kind of wave you through the gatehouse, because the gate itself is probably, it is about 20 feet deep. So you have to go 20 feet through the gatehouse, as it were, before you're actually on the other side of the wall and into the wharf. And this is where, when Kay mentioned the smell.
Yeah, like, as soon as they get through the gate, she's definitely pulling her little scarf thing up over her nose and holding it there. She knows.
Hey, August. August man, hey, I just wanted to say that I like totally appreciate what you did back there, and here you go. And he slips you 4 gold for himself and Leaf's entry.
Thank you.
Of course, man.
And you're welcome.
Who cheered? Share rewards. Somebody cheered. I'll have to look. Where's the... Oh. Half a rainbow. Thank you, Half a Rainbow, because I just noticed she gave us, we get to do one of our little Deus Ex Machinas. So we get to take a little time out here. And I got everybody tonight, so I'm going to go to roll 20. And in the chat, I am going to type / roll 1d5. And when I hit this, it's going to give me a roll number there in the chat 20, and I'm going to go according to how I see you on the Twitch screen. So Duke 1, Chris 2, Jaylee 2, or 3, Austin 4, Olivia 5. Okay? So only on roll 20 can you roll a 5-sided die, and we get a 4. And wouldn't you know it, that means that Bogard Blunt.
Yes. What did I win, man?
You get, hang on a second, copy and paste. I love this. This is the new little thing. People see it. He gets the cool little Deus Ex Machina. You can't see it,
unless you're actually watching Twitch. It's the audience can see it. You got this cool little emblem now on your frame. And what that is what we talked about at the front, because we got the 500 bits. Then one of you at random gets one of these little icons, and it is a free crit. If you want to take a hit and say, you know what, I'm going to make this hit and I want to make it a critical hit, you can do that, or a free save, or anytime you need the God from the machine to come in and make a save for you and do something, you can cash that chip in. If it makes sense narratively, I'll go for it. You know what I mean? Aww. There's probably a list out there I could come up with of cool special things, but that is the God from the machine. And you can thank Half a Rainbow, because for that one, she is the God in the machine tonight.
Thank you, Half a Rainbow.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You the best.
Thank you, Half a Rainbow.
I will use it wisely.
I keep
probably not.
Thank you, Easter Bunny. That's the commercial that comes in my head.
I rolled this joint. And I won.
Yeah. God, good enough, man. I'm gonna use my Deus Ex Machina.
Oh, for this.
To roll up my ankle.
This bowl is not packed tight enough. Deus Ex Machina.
You could use it for that if you wanted to, I suppose.
The world is your oyster. Oh my gosh.
All right. So that was cool. Too. Nice. Thank you. Appreciate the support. And there you go, Austin. You got a free roll. Write that down. I can see it on your little thing, but you'll have to remember when to use it, because I'm not going to remind you. I should start throwing me in the loop and give myself a little hand of God myself. To see how miserable I can really make it. It is dark and stinky, and it is the wharfs. You smell water, but this is not ocean water. You are a long ways from the briny sea. You are between a giant, enormous lake of unknown depths and 2 days from the sea, in between the two, in a big, huge, wide, slow-moving bend in the Skeleton River. So lots of things coagulate in that particular area.
Good word.
And it does give off itself a ripe smell. Luckily, the sheer mass of boat traffic helps break it up. But that, of course, brings new smells all on its own. So
I want new spells.
New spells. Breathe deep, you get a new spell. I think that's a druid thing.
Fireball.
Stinking.
Yeah, that's my class. Thank you.
So, because I haven't told you exactly where you're going, I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt that you kind of have an idea of where you're going. But let me hear your guys' conversation about how you plan to approach. This is unknown territory for you. You know that there are people outside of the law here. The City Watch does not patrol the wharfs. It has locals. I will say, locals with little air quotes that handle the law. And so it is dangerous territory.
I can only assume that you, Bogard, you, Leaf, can handle yourself, but just keep your head on a swivel, okay? There's, we may or may not have to do damage out here, okay?
I watched her slit the throat of my master. Well, I guess he was my boss. She can handle herself, man.
Jesus, that's dark.
He was a piece of shit, so, like, he deserved it for sure.
Oh, okay. Well, like, he deserved it.
He definitely deserved it, man. But still, like, it tripped me out a little bit.
Well, just be on your toes, all right?
Sure, man.
Okay.
Yeah. She's like, she's definitely on her toes. Like, if perception check, like every corner we turn, it's like, oh, what's going on? So she's not super in tune to the conversation. So you saying her name, she just kind of like snaps a little bit.
Do we need to, you know, slow down? Be quiet, or can we get there quick?
I mean, you are wearing kind of... People are going to notice us. We're a big group, so we might as well just keep going. I'd say we're at a good pace.
There's lots of traffic. Just to give you an idea of the feel of the place, I mean, where you're at right now, when you step through the gate, there's still a lot of traffic. But I don't know if any of you have spent any time in a large city and have gone down to where there is like a dock district or an area where there's like trains or that sort of thing. So there's lots of activity in a whole bunch of spots, but there's also a whole lot of dark passageways that lead to different businesses and lighted doorways sometimes, but lots of little small places, dark places to go down that are immediately out of the traffic.
Do we have to utilize those to get to the warehouse that we're going to, or do we take the majority of the way on the main thoroughfare?
You can take the main thoroughfare is going to be a little bit longer if you go all the way down to the riverfront side, the walk there, and then
which way would you take us, Kay?
With the group that we have now, I think we should take a few detours. And just, if you have anything valuable in your pockets, just hold on to them. Being in the crowds makes me kind of nervous. You never know if you're going to get pickpocketed or anything. So I think if we go down the side paths, we'll get there faster.
While we're having this conversation, Bogard's rolling a joint of Girl Scout cookies.
Like, while we're walking?
Yeah.
That's impressive. He's got some skills.
They're actually known as the Little Greyhawks around the city, and that particular organization of the female youth is really, I mean, they might still call that particular strain that thing, but that particular branch of youth activity has kind of died out. I don't think there's any little girls that are still in the Little Greyhawks, but I suppose they could still name some. Calamanthus.
That's hilarious.
Calamanthus. It's Calamanthus, folks, what we're talking about, and it is a little mix of homebrew. We've expanded on it, but if you Google it, it is out there. Somebody did put it into Greyhawk lore, and they do grow it at Griffin's Roost, where the Twilight Monastery is, and we did talk about that in one of the Zero sessions that I am still editing. Because they were technically not worthy of air from beginning to end. So I'm not sure if all that particular information is out there, but I've got some really cool outtakes out of those. So yes, that is Bogard's. What do they call that in magic, using your focus, I suppose, in a sense?
Material component?
Yeah, material component. Yeah, the focus is like the staff.
His MP.
Your pipe, I suppose. Okay, anyway.
Like different materials like a wizard would use.
So. Calamanthus. Amazing.
So, yeah, we've expanded on it. There is a market for it, but we haven't really gotten into that part of the story yet, but who knows where we're going to go. So, Kay's decision then is to cut down a couple of little alleys. Now, where you're going is really not too far off. As a matter of fact, let me go to the map. Where are you guys? Okay, you're at the wharves. And let me... do this for fun, and because I can now, because things are working so well for me. How are we doing on time? 8:07. And, let's see. Freehand. Yeah, see, you guys are... boink, there where the little purple X is. And, where you are going is right there.
Okay.
It's commonly known as one of Area Doc's warehouses. That is a person. That is a name of one of the bosses in the wharf. He's an importer and exporter of items, and his name is Area Doc, E-R-I-D-O-K-S, or Area Doc's apostrophe S and just the K. Area Doc sounds like Area Doc, A-E-R-E. Anyways, sometimes I have verbal diarrhea. There's Area Doc's warehouse. That's one of his warehouses. And so, yeah.
Okay. So, can I draw on this, like, the route I would take then?
You can, I believe. If you go up in the upper left-hand corner, you'll see a box that looks like a little paintbrush.
Yeah, I see it.
And then you can click freehand, or you can draw straight lines. Okay, so you're going to take that outside.
So instead of going alongside the main route by the water, she'd kind of go through the middle of it and then alongside the wall to get there.
Gotcha. And those round buildings are like grain storage, and there's lots of that sort of activity. And so you've got a little bit of hustle and bustle, but as you get back towards the wall, you're going to find yourself on the back side of these buildings, that what looks to be like one very tight road that might cut down the center of those buildings. I should look this direction towards the camera. I have a map over here too. When you cut down that center of buildings is more lit, the back way is going to be definitely darker, but a lot less foot traffic as well. So that's
I'm not scared of the dock.
I hear the Pink Panther theme in my head right now.
Well, I can turn into a panther man, but it's not going to be pink.
Well, fail.
Still a panther, though. I mean,
I think, like, just from Kay's point of view, she's used to taking the darker, more shadowy ways, so.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Definitely take the darker path. Helps her to blend in. So she's kind of wearing her expression, kind of, she's a little worried because she doesn't normally travel with this many people. Especially a giant and a cat.
Right.
But she still decides to lead them that way anyway.
So as soon as you come out the gate, Kay says, let's go this way. And you cut left behind that first building. And you cut through what looks to be some grain storage on this backside. You can definitely smell that you're probably close to a fish market of some sort, because that smell becomes extremely strong when you go back there. And then she guides you past the street You look down to your left, or actually, if you're coming from that direction, you're going to be looking right. And you look down that little tight narrow, and it's a pretty dark street. You can see what appears to be maybe a couple of professional people standing out in front of residences. A couple of open doorways with light casting through, a thug or two. But she doesn't take you down that street. She takes you behind those next two buildings where you come to the hill that would then lead up into the trees and to the wall. And you are now in darkness behind.
Hey man, I can't see in the dark.
I just grab your hand and guide you along.
Me neither, but we won't.
You just grab my hand. Oh, it's furry, so it's definitely.
Like total darkness?
Yeah, like how dark are we talking?
Like, yeah, there, like, it's nighttime and there is no torchlight. There is as much light as comes peeking through the cloud cover. So there's not really a lot at all. So it's just pretty dark. I'm just letting you know, because this is not a place where the brothers would normally go. So I'm just letting you know that there might be a sense of trepidation. Not sure how you guys handle it, but you get like, all right, so we're not going down the scary street. That's kind of comforting, but now we're going to go, oh, we're going down the back where there's, we don't know what's back here.
Well, as soon as I hear Bogard say that he can't see, I will tell everybody to stop and I'll light a torch.
Okay.
And I will also pull my sword out and my other, put it, you know what I mean, in my sword hand.
Jaylee, make a perception roll for me.
Okay. Not feel bad for leaving everybody into this dark.
I don't know how many dice that was, but just roll one of them, please.
I had to dump them out. I got a 10 plus 7, so 17.
When this torch gets sparked, Kay, looking down her intended mental path, you sense movement. Don't know if you saw something, but you think you saw something. Maybe? I don't know.
Do I, like, get a sense of what it could have been? Like, could it have just been, like, an animal?
No, just your spider senses went off that let you know that there might be something up there. You've had the feeling before. Sometimes it pans out.
It's a little more dark. I think there's someone ahead of us. There. I'm sorry. I usually travel alone, but maybe we should pop back through the other street. I don't know what's, but something moved.
Well, it's probably too late already. So just everybody be quiet. And I would like to, like, slip into the darkness a little bit and stealthy.
Same. I'm probably going to stay out of the torchlight if I can.
Curtis, well, I have...
Go ahead, Olivia.
Oh, sorry. I have seed of paraphernalia vision. Do I see anything in front of us?
You have what kind of vision?
60 feet of dark vision.
Oh, dark vision.
Same.
Likewise.
Okay, for those of you with dark vision, I'll give you a roll before he sparks the torch.
Another natural 18. All right. Let's hope I can do that during combat.
Are we rolling perception?
Yeah.
19.
What'd you have, Leaf?
23.
Aaron?
That's my girl.
I just rolled an 11.
Aaron, so disappointing.
I know.
Hey, I didn't even get a roll, man.
Mm-hmm. That's all right. You were busy. And
that's exactly right.
Well, you were excited about that torch getting sparked up. And so those other two that rolled, you also definitely, when she says that, as you're getting ready to spark that, you look up, you're lighting the torch, and you catch a glimpse that, yes, you two think you saw something move. It was down the ways. Probably 75, 100 feet off. Definitely past the edge of this long building that you were behind.
Wait, you guys saw something, man?
Yeah. Hold. Right. Yeah. So I will, as I see the two of them try to slip off into the shadows, I will step up to the front of the line.
21 for stealth.
Okay, yeah, that's where I wanted to go next, because the Nightingale, the homebrew class, where's that from again, Aaron?
Thieves Cant, Bartholomew There's... Click and Zachary Stoppel. Yeah. You can find it again at yesthievescan.com.
Plug, plug, plug. We always like to plug our friends. Since that is a skill of the Nightingale, I'm going to give you an opportunity to give me a little flourish with that one. So what does it look like when you, what'd you call it, hide in the shadows?
Yeah, let me see here.
I'm getting,
I mean, there's some... nothing specifically special about the way that that I fade into the darkness. It's just I mean, like, nothing magical, like, related to the
right.
the class itself. So yeah, I mean, I am just finding cover around buildings, moving swiftly and quietly.
Okay, and I get it. So yeah, you find the darkest of shadows along the back edge of this building, and then so I guess the intention then is you're going to creep forward. Of course, you'll have to compete with the torchlight a little bit. So does that put you out front a little bit, or are you
me? In,
no, I'm talking about Aaron in the shadows.
Yeah, I mean, because I do also have dark vision, I will be able to keep at least a little bit better of an eye around myself as I'm moving through the darkness.
Right.
So yeah, I will be moving ahead of the group.
As you creep down along the edge of this back building, Aaron is jetting ahead a little bit just outside of the torchlight. I'm gonna have to make a note of looking up exactly the now I've never did Duke, off the top of your head, do you know how far torchlight illuminates by chance?
10 foot normal light, 10 foot dim light.
Oh, well, that's not. I thought it would go further than that. Weak ass torches. they need like a magna torch.
Well, we need somebody that can cast light.
So Aaron doesn't have to go too far ahead. I'd like, if you're going to be stealthy, you have to kind of compete with the torchlight in my book. So that puts Kay and Aaron out just ahead of the group, just a smidge, as you get to the edge of the building and you can creep around. Is your intent to stay back behind, or do you want to jet down an alley and get back to that main road? You're about that little red mark is where we started this conversation at that building. So now I can actually...
I mean, I feel like it's fine that we just keep moving along the path that you drew on the map already.
Okay.
I don't know that we necessarily need to flee to the main thoroughfare.
Yeah. I say if the rest of the group is fine with that. Because, like I said, she's used to working alone, so she's just not sure how everyone else is...
Well, there's no
22 for stealth, by
but
the way.
We might as well keep going.
Yeah, there's no reason to backtrack.
Because there's going to be more thieves on that kind of main area than there is in this dark, dingy one. More thugs out and about.
Ute-nibute.
Especially in a city full of mostly humans who won't have dark vision. So yeah, let's keep going.
That's a good call, man.
It's good what? Good call.
We're plugging along.
Yeah, we're chugging.
He said good call.
Oh, okay. I missed it, sorry. So, yeah, you keep creeping along. That was not the song I wanted to hear. That song is not appropriate. Anyways. So with nothing else, yeah, you're going to creep along that back ledge. That's a hill to your left that goes up into some trees. And when you start to get to the edge and you're about ready to make the turn back around into back onto the street, as it were, past that last little red dot there on your right hand side, if you're following the little purple line around that building there at the end, after you pass a couple openings and stuff, you still get the same, those of you, excuse me, with the perceptions, and I'll still give you the benefit of the high rolls, have not shaken the sense of maybe not movement, but eyeballs. That feeling that you're being watched has hit and hit hard. Kay, I want you to make me an extra perception roll.
Okay. Um,
18. Okay. So as you're creeping around, that feeling settles in strongly with UK to the point to where you know that it's coming from multiple locations and you're not even sure if it's all the same faction. I'm sorry, lack of word. You know what I mean? That there could be more than one interest in mm-hmm. you at this particular moment. I, the reason I do that is I've decided, I made a little note of myself there during her zero session to give. I've got sort of a similar situation with you, August, and Aaron. I haven't talked to you guys about it yet. I haven't really talked to Kay about this either, but this was something I was coming up with in my head. An occasional role to trigger your either local contact or your street sense or some little added sensibility, give you an opportunity to dive into the fact that you've got some experience within the city, and that's where that perception comes from.
Okay.
Not that it requires action, just letting you know that's what's in your gut at this moment as you're about ready to head off into the ceiling, into the city. And
I hear anything, or I just feel?
You might have heard something. The reason that worries you is because if you did hear something, that they were stepping when you were stepping, which means that they're smart.
Okay. Because I was thinking if it was rat folk, like maybe I'd hear them, like, you know, sniffing around. But if they're smart, then...
All right. Well, then, because I was just about to send us to break. Before we go to break, I want all three of my locals to make a history check.
I'm rolling so average. History. I had 10.
I rolled a natural 3 plus 1.
I rolled an 8.
Well, I have a plus 0 to history, but I rolled a natural 19.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm
dude. Wow, rolling okay,
this die tonight. This
dude, is the die
that's that is the one
for the rest of the night.
Yeah, okay. So, all right. Well, then you guys will get the benefit of the doubt. And I do know you guys were talking about the rat folk when you were at the Whistling Fish as well. Over the last half a decade or so, rat folk have been one of the minority species to sort of set up shop, as it were. You will very rarely ever find them inside the city walls.
because they have to compete with the Thieves Guild and the Beggars Guild inside the city walls. Outside the city walls, especially in the wharfs, the rat folk have set up what we would call organized crime. They are prolific, just as rats would be. They are everywhere, and they are into everything, but they are as intelligent as the firbolg or the tabaxi in your group. If you remember, there was one in the cell in the city watch station there in the foreign quarter. He had on, short pants and a vest and, leather straps and a belt with what would have been things hanging off of it, but they were confiscated. So they are not savages, as it were, just to put a little perspective. And they have basically become competitive in the wharfs.
Okay.
But they are not typical out in the open. You're not going to catch them too often just strolling down the street, even in the wharfs. They tend to act like rats too.
And yeah, so, I think we would have been looking out for them the whole time.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, you've definitely got the sense that there could be some of them scurrying around. And with the thoughts of rat folk scurrying in our heads, this is where we'll take ourselves a little break. So go stretch your back, stretch your legs, get yourself something to drink. As Pumpkinberry says over on Table Story, be sure to watch your piss mittens. And we'll be back in about 10 minutes or so. So, yeah, we'll be right back. All right, let's see here. Okay, there's me, there's the music. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
All right, I hear you too. Okay. Well, not you too, but see, where's Beth when I need her? She's full of my puns.
We're in the wrong windows. I'm in Olivia's window.
Damn it. It did it to me. All right.
We've all pushed by one, I think.
Oh, man.
It scooted everybody around. No problem. I can fix that. Easy. Let's see. He needs to go over here. And let's see. He needs to go over there. I can do this on the fly. You guys are sneaking around the corner. Olivia. And everybody's off.
Yeah.
Duke, I'm good. I'm missing a cam. Who's who was that? No, don't do that. Wait. See that? Look, you guys messed me up. Oh, there we go.
I'll be Chris.
We're both rogues. It works.
Yeah, exactly.
Where's... Why can I not grab that? Oh, it's
I like that Chris is just like peeking right between behind me and Duke.
I am very sneaky. Like,
hello.
He's got all the sneaks.
Yes, that's... see, I told him, all right, let me see you hide in the shadows. All right, here you go.
Oh, we got him.
All right, I think I kind of shuffled my frames around just a little bit, but that's not too bad. Except I got one more to do. And... mine didn't go anywhere.
Oh, no!
Yeah, I know. That's what I said. I got one more to do. That's okay. I've got this.
Hey, man. I'll be Bogard for a little bit.
I'm getting better at this.
So. Yeah, man.
Yeah, man. There's only one Bogard, man.
I've known plenty of Bogards in my life, all
right? Benny Hill intensifies.
You've known a stoner cow person?
It's like those Scooby-Doo montages where they keep going through different doors.
Yeah.
What's new, Scooby-Doo? Blah, 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 blah. We're gonna solve that mystery.
I don't think that's how it goes.
I'm giving,
I don't think that's how it goes either.
Pretty close.
I gotta give Bogart his other... I forgot, he's got a... Gotta give him an emblem on both of his little windows there. Beautiful. Okay, so we're all good to go. All right, thanks. Well, welcome back. We're back from break. Everybody got something to drink. A little bit of shuffling around. I'm going to have to figure out how I can keep that from happening. That's one I've not seen happen when we go to break. Or else, we'll have to, anyways, sort that out. So, yeah, you've crept around the backside of this little section of the Warp District. And you have then landed yourself at the end where you're going to make your little slight right-hand turn back into town and down the road. Jaylee, or Kay, got the sense that they are definitely being watched or followed, probably, or for sure, by multiple entities, possibly even different interests.
So I am stealthy in the shadows. Would there be any way for me to like try to combat stealth and see if I can sneak up and somehow find who else is there? If that makes sense.
I mean, you want to try to pinpoint a bogey?
Yeah.
What was your... Yes. You rolled perception. What was that last perception roll?
It was 18. I rolled an 11.
You get the sense that there are eyes on you from the trees behind. There is suspicious movement in shadows on ground level ahead, and you're pretty sure you saw something scurry across the roof of the building to your right.
Okay. Aaron, are you still next to me?
I wasn't sure if we were close together or moving forward like
one on each side of the road.
Right. I know that I am gonna be on the building side because I'm using them as partial cover and like peeking in between the buildings as I'm moving.
Which of these entities is the closest?
The one on the roof.
On the roof. Am I able to like pinpoint exactly where on the roof?
No. You have arrived at a situation where your senses... and August, you're kind of getting the same situation, and Aaron, you probably are too, hiding in the shadows, where as you are looking as a rogue hiding in the shadows and in stealth mode, you are two shadows ahead of everybody else. You are not focused on the shadow that you're in. You're focused on the next shadow that you're going to and how you're going to get there. And you have come to a point to where you are uncertain about the shadows in front, meaning that if you jet off to that little dark spot, it may be occupied.
Ooh. I do have dark vision, so I should be able to see if there is something occupying a shadow that's in front of me.
How far does the dark vision go?
60 feet.
you don't see anything in the moment, and as far as the shadows from where you are at, I'm placing you. If you didn't see that, I've got you placed on the map, right there with that little. I'm gonna have to get better at my blobs. I'm gonna do fine point. Learn something new every day, Duke. Every goddamn day.
Every day.
Every day.
Well, I'm probably just going to take note of, like, where I think people are. I'm going to stay hidden and just, like, watch for now. Kind of staying, like, where Duke's torch circle is, like, just outside of it. Outside of the area of, like, light.
Okay. So as you make your way into, you're gonna walk into a clearing. That clearing's got some lit area. It's a big clearing. It's not completely lit, but there is a little bit of torchlight along the far buildings and along the path between the buildings where the purple line goes. When you get to just that space on the far edge of what I'm going to call that little courtyard area, that little open area on the opposite side of the blob before you head into the street where the blue line goes, that's when the first flick of an arrow goes flying by. And who's in the lead?
Well,
Aaron,
if they
and Kay are both in shadows,
then it's me. I'm definitely stepped out front with the torch in my hand.
And
I'm doing my best to make myself the obvious target.
What's your armor class?
20.
You are not hit, but you feel the arrow go flying right over you, and at that moment everybody's senses go off, and you can all hear scuttling. And you can also hear communication, language. Do any of you speak Thieves' Cant?
I do.
Hey, Bart.
And yes, of course, I do also.
Okay, so what you hear then are very sort of rough but squeaky kind of voices that start, they're basically yelling direction, you there, sort of things, up on the roof. And I need one of those skill lists in front of me. I think Beth sent me one. I'm stupid for not having it right in front of me. Need to check. I'm just not sure which one it is. Hang on.
What's it for?
I want to see if the player can get a sense of how many.
That's perception.
All right. Thieves canters. Yeah, make me a perception roll to my rogues.
Natural 4 plus 4.
Well, it slips right by Aaron Stone, but luckily it lands right on Kay, and she can discern that there are a lot of them, at least 10 or more.
Oh boy. That's awesome. Okay.
So, are we in initiative, or do we still have the ability to do something?
I'm going to give you a chance to make a decision. It's in the dark. That arrow could have hit you if they really, really wanted it to.
Okay, then I'm going to kind of take a couple steps out from kind of into the middle of the courtyard it's, you said it's kind of lit up, plus I have the torch in my hand, and I'm going to say, we're just passing through. We don't want any trouble, and you certainly don't want any trouble from us. And I'm not trying to be nice. I'm trying to be forceful.
Make a persuasion.
Can I use intimidation?
Yep.
That's my intent.
Yes.
Can I help him by turning into a panther with wild shape?
Well.
Yes. You can make your shape change, and Duke, you can roll with advantage.
Dope. Oh, a 15 and a 16. So 16 plus 7 is 23.
That beats the number I had. So the two rogues hear, well, everybody can hear a little bit of mumbling. The two rogues can kind of understand that there is a little bit of comprehension as to what's going on. And you had to, since you were kind of on the far end of that courtyard, you had to kind of step back a little bit, actually, to get actually in the back end of the light a little bit, or, you know, more into the light, as it were.
Okay.
And up ahead, kind of in the shadows, so that there is a torch behind them, and so they're silhouetted. You see this little figure. You see it start to come out of the shadow on all fours, but just as soon as it hits the light, you see it stand up onto two legs and sort of dust itself off real quick. And it turns. And in a little squeaky voice that I have not yet mastered, so I'm not going to quite embarrass myself with it yet.
Go. Oh, come on, give it to us.
Do it for the stream. I want to be immersed.
You want to be immersed?
Immersed.
Oh, immersed.
Yes.
Chad is calling for it as well.
Chad is half a rainbow. Oh, I love it. How many people are watching, by the way? Look, here's one of Hal Grimley's favorite.
Erica is mighty, she says in chat.
I am mighty. Yes, she is mighty. So the little rat folk person steps out from the shadows, but still silhouetted by the light behind them. And says,
"What are you all doing here on the wharves?"
Oh, that's perfect.
I love it.
I can't speak.
I'm not giving myself up. I'm
what's his name? We're on our way to Area Doc's warehouse. All right? We got business there.
Business? Who sent you business?
It's none of your fucking business. That's who. I already told you, we don't want trouble, right? We just want to be on our way.
Well, you got trouble, buddy. So, why don't you just, what you got? Swords and knives? You can throw all that down.
I'm in the shadows. I'm gonna have my short bow ready, just in case something goes on here. Yeah. And it's pointed at that guy.
My hand crossbow is already aimed.
Do you not... Hey!
Baron, those teeth. Like, really angrily.
Do you not see that I got two cat friends here? Two of them.
Cats v. rats, yo.
Delish.
Panther and big. Well, you don't, you can't see his expression because he's masked by the silhouette. But his demeanor doesn't seem to change. What was the last thing you said?
I said, you see, I got two cat friends here, right?
Yeah, I see your cats, man. I see your cats. I got guys. I got people all over the place. So, you know, that was just one little arrow. I got lots of them that go.
How far is he from me?
How far is your, you, how, what's your vision?
I'm 60 feet.
He is just outside of that.
Oh, he's 60 feet from me? Shit,
so does your, does your dark vision extend 60 feet beyond the torchlight? Or is it just straight 60 feet?
Yeah, it's just 60 feet.
Okay.
I can see into the dark the 40 feet past the light of the torch. Yeah, I don't have anything. I don't have anything that I can reach him with.
I do. So does Kay. And we're both trained on him.
I could jump him.
You got good jumps.
Got good jumps.
Panthers have something called jumping.
Yeah, but you can't get 60 feet. You can't get 60 feet in pounds.
Me?
It's at least 20 feet. Straight ahead.
Right, and he's 60 feet from you.
If the panther moves at least 20 feet. What's the... Oh,
but
no,
you, right, but right. You still have to be in range. You still have to be in range.
I was looking at the climb. He's his. Yeah, he has... Panthers have ridiculous climb height.
So we're at an impasse.
Oh,
I'm telling you, we want to move on. You're saying you want us to throw our stuff down. So either come over here and let me cut your fucking head off, or let us go.
Curtis.
Yep.
Can I use my feline agility and run at him and like pounce on him? Because that's what I want to do.
That's what you want to do.
Can certainly try.
Yeah. Yeah. I am.
I'm going.
Yeah, if the minute anybody moves, I fire.
Oh, yeah.
Because I can move up to double my movement speed, so that would be 60 feet.
Yeah, I am. Are you guys ready for that right now? Oh, damn it. Yes, you can do that. What we're going to do, though, is we're going to have to roll initiative for that. I'm gonna let you get that. I'm gonna let you get that move off as soon as I get going. But then we will. Then we are going to go into initiative. Where did my music go?
Garbage initiative.
That's not the music I wanted.
Olivia, a little off topic, but we have a very important question. Can Leaf speak cat? Half a Rainbow wants to know, if Bogard is a panther, can he meow and communicate with Leaf?
Okay, I say, I feel
like that's a little bit stereotypical to say.
I think so, Half a Rainbow. What the hell? just because we're both felines doesn't mean that we understand one another.
Racist.
I speak tabaxi, so I can speak to other tabaxi.
But you can't, like, go to a cat on the street and be like...
No, I don't... I think, I would imagine, like, I'd be more sensitive to their body language and what they're... Yeah.
Yeah.
A tabby just approaches you. Meow. What time is it?
Yeah. Yeah, that's...
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
When Leaf is lonely, Bogard turns into a panther.
That's cute. I rolled a 19 for initiative.
feel like I should just start rolling my actual dice again.
Yeah, I don't trust technology.
Helping me.
I did it. I did it in roll 20 just so that Curtis could have it right in front of him. I got a 19 rolling? For initiative.
Are we rolling?
Likewise.
For initiative? Okay.
Yeah, sorry. I'm messing with the map here. It went all wonky on me for a second.
Really? Half a rainbow? Ten solid minutes of just them meowing at each other?
That's the bonus features if you go and help out on our Patreon.
When we release this on Blu-ray, that will be
That'll be the first deleted scene.
Well, like, I rolled really well, and I'm like, now I don't want to roll on roll 20 because it's not going to be as good.
That's all right, because I didn't have the turn order thing loaded up, so it didn't lock them on my deal yet anyways. I'll have to put them all on. Anyhow. I'll have to... that reminds me, we're going to have like a Roll 20 lesson for you guys, too, just so you can do a couple of these little quick things if you wanted.
I got real excited just drawing that line on the map.
And why didn't it show me... Bogart. He's on the list, but it didn't give me his name. That's odd. Anywho, alright, so let's see. I'm gonna bring you guys over to this map. And it's just a quick little battle map. And it's not picture perfect to what you see, but it gives the same perspective as you guys are standing in an open area that is available behind you, and in front of you is a road section with one rat folk that has stepped out on the street in front, and then you've got two up on the rooftops that you can see up and to your right, and you know that there is another one back from behind based on movement. There is no light coming in front of him, so you can't see his face, but there is light back here, a torch or something at a doorway, we'll say. And that's what's giving him the silhouette. And now, let me flip, there we go, so the fans at home can see. And let's see, how come August is nameplated in there?
That was a really nice wipe, Curtis.
Oh, would you like that? And that's why Bogart didn't have his thing attached. My fault. This is one of those moments where I mumble to myself. Don't worry about it. I'm just fixing some token things. I learned more about tokens today.
Bogart's thing isn't attached? What the hell?
So, yeah,
it's all the Calamanthus, dude. It's got in your brain.
Yeah.
Where is it?
Now, everybody should be able to grab your token so that you can move there, it, man. If you need to. I just kind of threw them out there, so they are not in position. So feel free to grab them and put them where you think that you might be.
I'm drawing on things on accident.
I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt that you're... Oh, that's all right. I can take care of that. And you wanted to do what now?
I wanted to use my feline agility to charge at him and jump him.
Okay, so go ahead and is that... That's within your movement. How far is your movement? Just...
Normally it is, I think it's 30.
But you were using some big thing, weren't you?
No, it's 40. Okay, so normally it's 40 feet. So with feline agility, it would be 80 feet.
Man.
So
Tabaxi are so cool. I've never played a Tabaxi. I'm so old school. They didn't even have Tabaxi when I played Dungeons and Dragons. We used to make up races. I will say, though, that in my homebrew day, just for some terrible segue, because this is what Curtis does, starts rambling on about something, I did create this homebrew race that I said was had demon descent, and I gave him like little horns, but I made him humanoid. And this one that I modeled, I was huge into wrestling back then, and this particular guy, this character looked like, you know, in wrestling, you remember the wrestler named Sting?
Of course.
Yeah. And he had the white flat top and the face paint.
Yeah.
Imagine him with horns, right? With like little curly, yeah.
Take
so I was making tieflings before I even knew that there were tieflings.
It's not a band, Erica. It's a single member of the police.
I don't even want to know what that is. How embarrassing, Erica. You should have known that. Okay. All right. Back at it. So, all right. So, it's definitely within your movement. Make me an attack roll, then.
Me? Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. I got us all completely distracted.
Oh, you're fine.
Kay wanted immersion, and I keep blowing it with
the reminiscence. The voice is good, though. Okay. The voice is great.
So, to hit, that would be a 13.
A 13. Oh. A 13 is a miss.
God.
It looks real cool, though.
But if she is in melee, that gives us advantage on our sneak attacks.
Yeah. Well, I'm still going to run up to him and try to, like, jump in, but obviously... So I would still be there.
Yeah, you'll still be right there in melee with him.
Yeah.
Yes.
Do you guys like the grid? I can check that out. I can put a grid on.
Ooh.
Fancy.
If you look at that.
Yeah, here, I'll move him.
Just
back.
Look at it.
Look at that grid.
Look at that grid. That is the greatest. God darn grid I ever did see. So yeah, he dodges as only a rat could dodge an oncoming cat. And okay, so now everybody give me your initiative numbers. Aaron?
Mine was 11.
August?
19.
Bogart.
19.
Look at you guys. Leaf.
15.
And Kay.
23.
Oh. Wow. Get it.
I rolled a nat 19. I was like, ooh.
Yeah.
I did learn how to make macros for my initiative rolls, so all I gotta do is click them and then click the button. So that makes that easy. Then I put them in descending order and... Oh, where did your numbers go? Damn it. Switch you... Alright, sorry. They switched you guys all to zero. Why did it do that? Kay, can I get your number again?
23.
I just put all those in. Leaf?
15.
Bogard.
19.
August.
19.
I already updated mine.
Oh, very good. All right, now we'll go descending order. All right, there we go. This is not action music. Where'd my action music go? Okay, that puts Kay up first.
Woo! Yeah, I as soon as I see that cat, like, bounding towards this rat man. I have my short bow trained on him, and I'm going to attack with that.
With advantage.
With advantage? Oh, cool. I'll take it. That helped. 19 to hit.
She didn't have to be in melee for that.
Leaf is in melee, just so as long as she gets it. Advantage.
Okay.
Yeah, Leaf's in melee with him, so.
If I ask about a rule, it's usually not to challenge it. It's more just so that I have a better understanding of how it works.
Yeah, it's no sweat.
So, that's definitely a hit.
All right, and I have sneak attack bonus. So, 5... 14 damage.
And what were you using?
I was using my short bow.
Oh, your short bow.
I had the
bow.
Sneak attack. Yeah.
So, Leaf, you go to make your attack. He dodges out of the way, and at that moment, an arrow flies right past you and just hits this rat person right square in the throat, all the way through it, and it just gurgles and collapses at your feet.
And then as a bonus action, I'm going to use a cunning action to go back into hiding.
Okay.
So we'll see. Do I need to roll a stealth for that?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Nat 20.
Oh my god.
Right, I'm fine. Very
You're freaking invisible.
All right, fine. Okay. Dang.
So she comes out, she goes, ching, and whoosh, disappears.
All right, so he drops dead.
And this is the guy that was talking shit?
Yeah. Yeah, it's the one that was talking shit. And that's when you hear a lot more scurrying than you had heard before. And this one up on the rooftop is going to fire at the cat. As soon as I find what I did with his character sheet, there it is. With a light crossbow, and that is a 16 to hit.
That hits.
It does.
Which one fired?
The first one up on the roof up here.
Okay.
Shoots with the light crossbow, hits Leaf, and if I pull that box up, I can go click that, and that does 6 points of piercing damage.
All right.
It also moves. And that brings us to August Stone.
Okay. Can I see any of them?
You can see the 3 that you see on your map. Those 2 have made themselves visible that you can make an attack on them. They're on the roof. Those 2 to your right, and then there is 1 down the alley that is has poked itself out from behind that corner.
Okay.
Kind of behind the boss down there. Which is, that other one, I guess, was a lot closer than I had initially anticipated, but I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt that you've moved up a little bit since we've initiated, but
I'm just going to use double my movement, and I'm going to get right up on top of that one. I can't do anything besides that, but I'm right in his face.
Okay, and that's... You don't have an attack action to make?
No, I used my action to dash.
I got you.
That brings us to the druid.
Question.
Yes.
The person who shot Leaf on the roof.
Uh-huh.
How high is it to the roof?
That is on top of a two-story building. So I'm going to say between 20 and 30 feet into the air.
Because I have 50 feet of climbing movement.
Oh. Well, yeah, but what's your regular movement speed?
40.
1, 2. Yeah, you could do it. You could get to the side of the building and then climb 15 feet up the side of the building. Because you're going to use... Well, I guess you could probably get to the roof. Because you're going to use 25 feet to get to the building, and then it's another 20 to 25 feet up.
Would you agree that that just wipes my movement, or are you wanting more, Curtis?
I would let you get up there. Does that... The extra movement, that doesn't take an action like what you just did, though, does it do?
No.
No, I'll let you... You can get up there and make an attack.
I will bite his fucking head. I will attempt to bite his fucking head.
All right.
Natural 16.
That hits.
Plus 4. 1d6 plus 2. 7 points of piercing.
So you have got this rat folk by the neck in your jowls. And let's see, that one is dead. That brings us back to Leaf. August has run up in front of you. The one that was directly in front of you is dead. Bogard's got one in his mouth on the roof. And there's one more on the roof up above, and then the one in front of August.
When I use my feline agility, I can't move on the next turn. I don't move it on one of my turns. Okay. So I am not going. Sorry. It says, when moving on my turn in combat, I can move double my speed. Once I do this, I can't do it again until I don't move at all one of my turns. So could I move on this turn and then not move on another one?
Because you just did your double last move, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is the one that you can't really move on if you want to, yeah.
If you want to use it again... Mm-hmm. You can't move this turn.
Oh, okay. Is that how that goes?
But you could move just your normal movement. But you still can't use your feline agility until you stop moving for an entire turn.
Okay.
So you could move this time and then stop next time and not move, choose to not move, and then use your feline agility the turn after that.
Okay.
So it doesn't stop you from moving altogether, but you can't use it again until you choose to stop moving altogether.
How far? How do you get the ruler?
The ruler, it's the over in the upper left-hand corner, the little thing looks like a comb.
Mm-hmm.
And then you, I put it on no snapping so that you can just put it in the center of your thing and then, oh, I drug it. Yeah, there you go.
Okay, yeah, I
want to
climb on that rooftop. intent to attack this rat folk, right? This rat person with the boot up.
How much movement do you have?
I have 40.
Okay.
Boo! That was a natural one.
Oh. Olivia, you are cursed.
No, it hit 19 and then it just
toppled over.
Bummer.
Well, I'm there, so.
And then it booped over. Okay, so make a dexterity save for me, please.
A
20?
Yeah.
Okay. Aaron, it's your turn.
So, can I see the ones that Leaf and Bogard are currently all up in they face?
Yes, they are just about 20 feet up on the edge of the rooftop at the top of the street where you're at.
Okay, well, then I will take a sneak attack shot at the one that is currently engaged with Leaf.
Okay.
Let's see. I don't think that I have my... Yeah, I don't have it in there. So, that is plus 6. And how do I roll it at advantage?
If you are doing it off the... Are you doing it in the roller or the character sheet?
The dice roller, yeah. I mean, I guess I can just click it twice.
Yeah. I forgot to do that one.
24 probably hits.
Yeah!
Much better than that, too.
Yeah, a 24 does hit.
Oh, doggone it. Didn't mean to just click that. So, D6 plus 4 plus another 2D6? Yes. So I rolled a 1 for the D6 itself. Another 1 and a 2.
Jesus. Oh my gosh.
Jesus.
How much is that total?
4 on a fucking sneak attack. God.
You don't have a damage bonus?
Oh, yeah. Plus 4. So 8. 8 total damage.
Great.
Okay. So you got the shot off. It was definitely a hit. Did some damage. Does not kill it.
Okay. I am going to use the rest of my turn... movement to move over here and hide again with my my bonus action.
Okay.
And my stealth is actually plus 8. I can't figure out how to put expertise on my sheet in here. But the stealth roll is 24.
I'll have to look at that.
Oh, he does a good hide.
Yeah.
I do a good hide. I just don't do a good damage.
So, yeah, you give this rat guy a hurtin' and then dive out of the way. He doesn't see you, but it may have something to do with this giant cat that's standing right in front of him, and it is actually his turn in the initiative. And so they are going to... use a dagger. 18.
To hit who?
Leaf, I'm sorry. Yeah, Leaf.
18 hit?
Yeah.
Oh.
Is that a hit? Yeah.
You have the
least amount of health. First level monk, does an 18 hit you? It's like, oh, it's man. Like the
kitty cat.
You're third level.
Or third level monk. Does that hit you? It's like the Incredibles meme, you know? DM, does 32 hit? And then Mr. Incredible sitting at the table just staring into it.
Right. 5 points of piercing damage.
Oh, Jesus. And you're up on the roof? Jesus, I can't do anything for you.
I was about to say, it's a good thing we both have healing spells.
I do too.
They're on the edge of the roof.
Yeah, but you're a cat. You can't really do much for her at the moment.
Not right now.
And as those maneuvers happen, there is a another rat folk that has made itself known from the other side of the roof peak on that far side that has tossed and missed with a net towards the tabaxi.
Okay, I lost connection for a second. What did I miss?
Oh, okay, there was the ratfolk rogue that was tangled up with Leaf in the Wind. Did do some damage with her. She had initially, on her last attack, dodged a net. And so another ratfolk has appeared on the roof that has tossed a net.
Oof. Okay.
At the tabaxi. And it is now ratfolk red. Their move. Oh no, wait. Nope, green, sorry. Down there with August. And a dagger attack on August.
Bring it.
15?
No, I have an AC of 20.
You have an AC of 20. Comes at you with a dagger. Easily dodged. And Kay, it's your move. We are back at the top of the round.
Okie dokie. Is each grid like 10 feet of movement?
Five.
Five? Okay. I go.
Double check my measurement. Yep, five.
All right. I'm going to peek out around the corner here. And yeah, I'm going to shoot at the blue dot rat folk that is currently in combat with our favorite kitty cat.
Go for it.
Rude. That bard deserves all the love.
I did not roll great. 13 to hit.
Advantage. Don't forget.
Oh, yeah. Awesome.
Aaron, you're out of cam.
Yeah, that hits.
I am aware.
Oh, okay.
25 to hit.
25 hits.
Nice. Yeah, if I didn't have advantage, I probably would. Okay. Let me get my dice.
All the sneak attack. Don't do minimum damage like my brother.
2, 11.
No, I'm just like, they're just rat folk. I mean,
a bomb. 15.
And you were shooting the blue one, right?
Yeah.
That's 2 in a row, Leaf.
I got you. I got your back. This Kills. Is all. Kay is just like so enamored by Leaf. She's like, don't kill the cat.
I just slowly turn from where that arrow shot down. Just look.
And yeah, Kay logs a kill. That one drops. And the one from behind notices its buddy go down, but has to untangle with this other giant cat that has climbed up onto the roof. Kay, did you have any movement or anything that you wanted to do?
No, I moved another 5 feet and I'm going back into hiding again as my bonus action. I rolled 18 stealth.
Okay. And the one right in front of you, Bogart, comes at you, the cat, with a dagger and with an 8.
The hit?
An 8 hits?
No.
A panther?
No. It's a 12 armor class.
Okay, so yeah, the panther dodges out of the way. And that brings us back to August Stone.
We're gonna take a big old swing. 11 plus 6 is 17. 17 to hit?
17 does hit.
Three plus six is 9 points of slashing damage.
Good hit. Just a rat folk, though. Still alive. Do you have any other movement you want to do? Or are you just going to stay tangled up with that one?
No, I'm going to stay right there. I'm not doing anything else.
Bogard the Panther.
I have a dude's head in my mouth, right?
That's what you said? Yeah, you do, actually.
I'm going to try to rip his mother head off.
Which is probably why he missed with that dagger. Was trying to do the thing. All right, so make your bite attack.
Yeah, basically just another bite attack.
Okay.
Natural one.
You get a good shake on him like any good kitty could do, but he's braced for the ride. It sounded like you were rolling a steel die.
I know, it sounded cool.
Was there anything else you wanted to do on your turn?
It says one attacks per action. Do I get to use a bonus action to make another attack, or am I just done?
No.
Okay.
Not unless then, it says.
No, I just hold on to the dude's head.
Okay.
What's that
so
one?
You're hanging on to him, and then that brings us back to the other cat on the roof. The other cat on the hot tin roof. Leaf you in.
Theater nerd joke.
I am going to run back to where I guess Aaron is and hide. Attempt to hide. That's what I'm gonna do.
Yeah, where are you at hit point wise?
3.
Oh man.
I feel like I should probably toss you a heal when you get over here.
So that would be an 18 still.
Yeah.
Can't roll the hit, but can roll the hide.
Yeah.
As any good Twilight Monastery monk, you deftly maneuver yourself back into the shadows and into safety. Feel free to drag your token wherever you want to be, or you should be able to. Let me know if you... There you go. Good job. It's supposed to be set up so you guys can move them, so if it doesn't, let me know. And was that the end of your turn then, Leaf?
Yeah. Sure is.
All right. That brings
are
us
to... Are you going
to
tell me that you are injured? I mean, I can probably...
Okay, I'm going to look at you and just be holding where the arrow is. Probably like in a dagger in the blood. I'm just gonna stare at you.
Yeah, and she
back down and stare at you again.
Considering the way she looks and where she landed, it might be.
Well, it's a good thing you landed here, I guess. And I will cast Cure Wounds at first level. Touch heal for a d8. Hopefully I don't get minimum fucking heals. Like I got minimum fucking damage. You heal 4 points. It's not much, but it's something.
I'm purring right now.
Purr. Oh my god, that's adorable. I'm sorry, you're a giant cat person, but that's adorable.
Burn stops.
We don't have the Sai and Kara relationship. This is a whole new character set.
Aaron, did you have anything
That has to be my action, so I can't really do much of anything else. And I don't plan on moving from where I am right now, so that's it. That's my turn.
Okay. So the other rat folk that was up on the roof that had thrown the net at the tabaxi takes a shot at the panther with his crossbow and rolls a 15-20 to hit.
15?
Well, it was a 15, but it comes out to a 20 because he's got a plus 5, so...
yeah. The dice came out on the screen. That was so cool.
Yeah, I got little pink dice. Little pink dice. Yeah. I think that's a John Cougar Mellencamp song, isn't it?
probably.
Light crossbow, yeah, so... That is going to do... 5 points of piercing damage.
Okay.
Still in your cat form?
Yeah, I still got 10 left.
Outstanding. Damn druids. Okay.
It's been so much fun.
That one is dead. I can take him off the list. And that brings us back to Ratfolk Green, right in front of August, who takes another swipe with his dagger. Gets a 24 this time.
Oof.
6 points of piercing damage. I'm assuming a 24 hits. What was that incredible AC that you told me you had?
Not a 24.
I think you're muted.
I have an AC of 20.
There you go, buddy.
Okay.
Sorry.
You're good. All good. Okay, so yeah, 6 points, and then that brings us back to the top of the round with Kay.
Alrighty, let me look here. I'm doing pretty good with my sneak and shoot here. How does the rat folk in front of Duke look in front of August?
Pretty beat up.
Pretty beat up. And then there's the one that Bogard has in his mouth. Hmm.
You would have advantage against either one of those.
Yeah. Well, I'm watching, you know, Kay's a very observant person, and she can't help but notice that the panther is having a really hard time actually hurting that rat folk. She's probably the Calamanthus, right? So, would I be able to shoot it while it's in its mouth? Or would that be like...
He's got a mouthful.
I'm going to say yes.
Okay. That'd be super cool.
I was going to warn you ask me questions like that, my immediate reaction is to go, yeah, but I'm going to give you disadvantage. But I'm just going to let you have this one, because I'm going to let you know, you ask questions like that, I might throw you a whammy.
Woo! I say I already have advantage.
Don't rub it in, Kay.
13 plus 6, 19.
19's a hit.
Sweet.
How much damage can you do?
Let's see.
That's the question.
Ooh, that wasn't good. I got a 2 and a 1. Another 2. 4, 5, plus... what's my bonus again? I think it's 4. 9 damage.
Yeah, it's hurting pretty good. That was a good hit. It's not technically dead. It's going to... did you have any other movement or anything that you wanted to do?
I'm
going to
do the same thing I've been doing.
Just
sneak back.
Sneak back.
18 stealth plus 7, so yeah, I'm hiding. I got 25 to stealth. This has been a good dice set for me. Except for those last sneak attacks. That sucked.
It's a new set, too, right?
Yeah. I'm pretty sure August has it handled, so...
The one in the mouth gets one more shot with his dagger at the cat. on his little last attempt with a natural one and just has not enough life left to do anything. Probably even touches it, like the tip of it, to you, but just doesn't have the strength to actually poke it in and do any damage. And then that brings us to August Stone.
Ooh, let's give him a little slicey slice. 18 plus 6 is 24. This die loves me tonight.
Yeah, I'm telling you what, 24 is a hit.
You boop that rat.
Out max, of existence.
Max damage, baby. Oh, that's 14
well, I'm glad points. I let you handle that one yourself.
Metagaming at its finest, ladies and gentlemen.
Right. So, August, yeah, you kill it. Do you do anything spectacular when you just destroy this rat folk guy?
Oh, I take his head off as cleanly as I possibly can. And yell, I told you so!
It's true.
He's not wrong, you know.
And okay, did you have anything else that you wanted to do in your moves? You've been standing in that place for a while.
Yeah, I don't see anybody else around, correct?
No, correct. Yeah, that other one's going to be over the peak of the roof, so
yeah.
You're going to be able to see him.
Yeah, then I'm going to I'm just going to hang out here and wait and see what happens, because I'm sure as hell not trying to climb any walls.
Okay. That brings us to August, then Bogard. You want to finish this one off?
So, is it just him and I on the roof? Is there another...
There's one more on the other side of the peak, basically up here at the top.
How far away from I from him?
15 feet.
Okay, can I throw the dude in my mouth off the edge of the roof?
Yes.
Okay, I do that, and then I run over to the other dude. Are you gonna let me get an attack?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
I thought you were gonna throw the dude into another dude.
Hey, oh.
14.
Ooh, 14 just hits.
Ooh.
Okay, 1d6 plus 2. 5. Flashing. I did it. No, piercing. Sorry, it was a bite.
Anything else?
It wasn't 20 feet, so I can't pounce. I mean, yeah, that's all I can basically do.
Very good.
Yeah.
Leaf in the wind.
Right. So I am going to move from my position to the rat that Bogard is engaged with and attempt to hit him with my claws. Slash his throat open. That's my goal.
So you're going to go back up the roof?
Yeah, I am.
I sure am.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, and you know what happened when I rolled? I rolled a mother fucking one.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Well,
today is not my day. I'm putting this dice away.
That's no good. So that was your attack roll?
Happens. Yeah, that was my attack roll. Okay. So, yeah, I'm here. Cat buddies for life.
But you missed, and... that's not good because the rat folk is there, but okay, He's going to actually swipe the dagger at the black cat that was there first and rolls an 11.
12 AC.
Oh.
Woo!
Misses. That brings us to Aaron Stone.
So I can't see that one from where I am, can I?
No, not from down on the ground where you're at.
And how tall is the roof of this building that I am next to?
Two stories. Well, the one, the end of it that you're on, I believe is one. Hang on a second. I'm going to, hey, everybody at home, watch this. Oh, wait. Grab it first. Numb nuts. One, yeah, the, yeah, it's two stories all the way. I was thinking maybe first part was a little lower. It's just a different roof peak, but it's still technically two.
Well, I cannot climb that, so I'm just gonna chill, I guess. Let's see.
Make me a perception roll.
From where August is, he can't see the other one, right?
Correct.
Man, my perception rolls have been absolute garbage all night.
I would say that it's probably pretty possible just because that your teammates continue to jump back up on the roof and you've even seen a body come flying off the edge and go down on the bottom and die, that there may be some other stuff going on up there, but you can't actually get a visual law.
Well, no, and I was thinking more... like, well, yeah, no, they're both still up there, so must be something up there. Okay, well, then what I'm going to do... I have 30 feet of movement, so I will just join my brother.
Okay.
And I can't really hide, but I'm going to roll stealth anyway.
I reach out, give you the knuckles as you walk by.
Mm-hmm.
You just hide behind him. He's got big armor.
Yep.
Very good.
With a 20.
I just hold my shield up. You're fine.
Okay, what do you want to do?
So the building I'm next to... how tall would you say that is?
That one is, let's see, I believe it's also a two-story. That first little part that you see with the chimney, mm-hmm. That is a one-story level. That second part of the building is two.
Oh, fantastic. So
yeah.
Well, with my rogue deftness, I am able to climb at my same running speed. So I have 30 feet of climbing. I'd like to climb up this top level and see if I can get a view of the rat folk from there.
You can.
Awesome. I will shoot at him. The team and advantage. 19.
19's a hit. Nice shot. Yeah.
And then plus bonus. Into 2, 3, 5, 11, 15 damage.
Okay, so you pop up and with your arrow you finish that last rat folk off that you see over on the other edge. Just both of you, Leaf in the Wind and Bogart Blunt, that are on the roof, my two feline friends, it takes an arrow right in front of you and drops dead. And Kay, I need you to make me a perception roll.
Okay.
Continually protect the kitten.
Yes, keep the kitten safe. 13 plus 7, so 20.
You make the shot. And you think to yourself, that is the end of that.
Yeah, but I heard about 10, so...
Well, with the perception roll like that, you realize that you probably heard considerably more than 10. And what it calls you to do is you turn around and you look back over your shoulder into that courtyard behind you that you can't see on this map. But the one that you got across as you hit this little bottleneck, and there are some more rat folk. And when I say some more, I would say that there is a swarm of rat folk, probably 20, 25 or more, all in various tatters of clothing and scarred, some of the ugliest 3 foot tall two-legged rat things that you've ever seen, snarling of all shapes and sizes, some of them fat, some of them skinny, some of them shorter than others, some of them taller than others, but there is a lot of them.
Well, that is less than ideal.
Yeah, I'm gonna jump off the roof and turn to them and just yell, like, we gotta go. Like, we gotta get out of here.
And it is with that massive mafia of rat men standing in front of you that we're gonna end tonight's episode.
Of course.